leadership is going?
Well, the first, you know, we went down to the UN's compound, which is really what it is. It's a giant compound just outside of the city. And the first thing we noticed is it's basically a cross between a gigantic green trade fair and an, if you've ever been to a evangelist conference, if you put those two things together, that's pretty much what COP15 is at the official UN site. So, you know, there's plenty of mainstream media that are going to cover what's going on there. And for us, there was no need to be down there because that every other 5,000 other journalists are covering the same thing. So we went to the meeting organized by Common Sense or Climate Sense, sorry. And Lord Christopher Monckton is one of the chairs of that, as is CFACT, an organization you're probably familiar with. You've had Mark Moreno on your show in the past. He's a great advocate, great speaker about this issue. And it's, you know, there's just a fantastic lineup of speakers there from Dr. Nils Axel Mourner, a sea level expert. We interviewed him today. We interviewed Ian Plimer, who wrote the best-selling book Heaven and Earth. He's from Australia. Very animated, very articulate, fantastic. But none of these guys will be allowed a platform over at the summit. For the UN. And so we at this meeting have invited anybody to come and listen and observe, but over there invitations from the people that we have are not extended. So it's kind of a, you know, it's kind of a lopsided discussion.
And Copenhagen is also the official UN event, as you know, but for those that may not, any even mainstream media that's been critical of them are refused. You have to agree with them to be able to attend, to give people an idea of just how authoritarian and dictatorial these ghouls are.
Sure. The UN declared Copenhagen as a UN territory during these 2 weeks here. Now, how official that is or unofficial is, you know, you can debate. But you've got half of Denmark's police force currently in the city. There's a group called Climate Camp, who's put up on their website publicly that they're, next Wednesday they're planning to storm the UN compound and occupy it and, you know, forcibly remove anybody that's in their way because they want to talk about real solutions to climate change. And I find the whole thing completely comical because everybody inside that conference and all these people who are going to storm it all still subscribe to man-made global warming theory.
And, well, I mean, to explain how this works, the foundations on record bring in the radicals to tear stuff up so they can then attack any other protesters and set the precedent to shut down free speech and free assembly globally. And they've caught them all over the world, police staging this or hiring these foundation thugs. A. B, by them acting like fools, that will make the people pushing for the carbon taxes look more reasonable. So it creates a false extreme. Do you want the communists that want total control or just the loving banks that will reasonably tax you?
Sure, they're loving to frame this in a left versus right issue. You know, on the left, you have activists and hippies and anarchists, and on the right, you have big oil and big business who are apparently funding skeptics. And really, this isn't a left-right issue at all. And when you go and you meet some of these people, scientists, economists that we've talked to, they've got no partisan interest whatsoever. They're not getting a penny from big oil. Every single one of the people and speakers at this conference have come there on their own dime. They paid for their own travel at their own expense. If it was funded by big oil, this would be in the Marriott downtown or the SAS Radisson. Instead, we're in some back conference, small little room in Christiana, which is right outside the hippie district.
Meanwhile, so all the big oil company executives are there in Copenhagen calling for stronger global taxes because they're owned by the big banks that are going to run this.
Sure. I mean, it's a giant slush fund is what it is. And that's evidenced by the Danish text leak. The World Bank is going to be handling the slush. So, you know, and the other thing is the sort of desperate political moves by people in the U.S. who are desperate to ram through cap and trade legislation in 2010. Okay. And the reason part of this Danish text leak is very revealing, because there's only two things that have kept hardline opponents of Kyoto from supporting Kyoto. One is they don't like the fact that the rich countries have to shoulder the burden for emissions. Okay. Check that box. The next box is they don't like the fact that the UN is handling the money. So in these Danish text leak, there's two things. The World Bank can handle the money, and they're going to stick it to the developing world to cap their emissions. So they thought they could, by appeasing these two problems with right-wing opponents of Kyoto, they could ram through cap and trade. But it's obviously backfired in their face. It's invading all sorts of areas. They're going to see opposition from places where they haven't anticipated it. And it goes to show that a lot of these political elites are not very bright. They're very clever, but they're not very bright.
Well, what's happening is people are leaking this in the age of the internet, and it's confirmed to be accurate. The London Guardian was leaked the information, and the third world knows it's the IMF and World Bank, and reading it, it's actually both of them, but mainly the World Bank, as you said. They know those are the groups even worse than the UN, with loan sharking rates feeding on their countries. So that's why the third world, the news was showing the delegates crying, going, we came here thinking we were finally going to get money for our starving people and also some money for ourselves. A lot of them are corrupt, like government is, period. And now they're finding out it's a total bait and switch. But we already knew that in Fall of the Republic, folks, as we were reading their documents. This is private corporate dictatorship. I cannot say that enough. Taxing the very air we breathe.
Alex, the political elite have become so detached from reality with through this climate change mythology. They've ghettoized themselves in a way, and they have no idea what the majority of the people feel about it. And the majority of the people, if you poll them, they see right through it. But they're so isolated in their sort of mythology of global warming and climate change.
That's right. Go ahead.
It's, the Emperor's New Clothes, how fitting. Craig Rucker from CFACT pointed this out today. So how fitting we're in the city of Hans Christian Andersen, and the Emperor has no clothes. And it's the global warming Emperor who has no clothes. And no one can, the people in this summit cannot see it.
That's right. He wrote The Little Mermaid. He wrote all those great children's stories. And he did write The Emperor's New Clothes.
Yeah. There's a Christmas tree downtown, Alex, in the center of town. It's being lit. The Christmas tree lights are being powered by people on bicycles, okay? Pedal-powered Christmas tree. If this treaty goes through, you and your staff are probably going to have to run your studio on bicycles.
Unless the globalists give us a special little chit saying that we're allowed to have electricity. See, it's not just taxes. According to this treaty, unelected corporate boards are allowed to decide who can even have a new technology. It's actually a dark age system. They advertise that, it's going to fund new technologies. No. They decide who can get funding for technologies, thus controlling it. And are people there on the ground realizing this is an attempt to reinstitute feudalism?
Well, yeah, this is really a reverse play of colonialism. So they've come now to colonize the middle class of the developed world. They're done with the developing world. It's been colonized and it's held in place, and this treaty would keep it that way. Now the next thing is you. The middle class is like a giant cow, and every reparation in this treaty is another hand milking that cow. The ability to revoke intellectual property rights, a 2% tax on every financial transaction, etc. The list goes on and on and on. And Lord,
a global authority over all air traffic and taxes, setting up a global government police force and tracking system, taxes on all the fuels, taxes on, it's 700 plus new bureaucracies.
Sure, that we're all going to pay for it at the end of the day. As if we don't have enough bureaucracies to contend with it, as if we don't get enough letters through the post, as if we don't have enough fines that we have to look out for paying and so forth. So
this is like Marie Antoinette saying, let them eat cake. Everybody's starving to death, and they say they want bread, they want bread. And she said, it's reported she said that, let them eat cake, and everybody finally goes crazy. I mean, the bankers are up there literally eating the real economy.
Yeah, I mean, I it's